okay?
Today he's here, I apologize. Today he's here just to teach you that sometimes good people are not always good bosses. Thank you, Phil. And the only note I have to tell you is like we have some technical difficulties. So the PowerPoint he prepared will not be able to project. Do you have the hands out? Mm-hmm. So you have to follow and take notes. Also, the all the materials you have, it will be posted on the website, plus the video. We are very thankful to NWTC who is here today to record the session. So if you would like someone else to see the presentation, you will have the opportunity to show that. Thank you, and I will give the mic to Phil. Thank you, Phil.
Finally, my turn. Okay, good. She's right. The genesis of that book, and the book was written in 01 and 02 and published in 04, and the only reason that we dealt with it, Ken Utek and myself, is because of this challenge that why do good people for some reason become good bad bosses and inadvertently, unknowingly de-energize the people within their organization? And how do you work with people at the top to somehow make them aware of what they're doing and you know, help them correct it, which is not my life's work, but it's certainly a major part of it. And I want to thank Kelly Ellis very much for doing the PowerPoint. I have no capability in that, and she did it for me. At least we have it printed, so we'll work through it after a while. And they're right. I mean, I really do care. It took me like 20 years to figure out this culture thing. And I think I do have it figured out, so I am passionate about it. And one thing we tell people is that once you know something, you stop learning. And unfortunately, I think I know it, so I've stopped learning about it, apparently. And that's not good. But I'll make some other comments about that a little bit later. But culture, you're here because you care about it. You know that we've heard the phrase culture eats strategy for breakfast, that man, if we don't have the culture right, the rest of the organization is not going to be completely effective. How do you get there? I've wondered about that too forever. I mean, we know that culture is everywhere. I'm going to just talk about a couple little anecdotal things that I've dealt with in the last day or so. I had breakfast yesterday morning with a fellow, and he's just finished a consulting assignment for a couple of months with a plant down in Milwaukee. The plant is one of many of a very large multi-billion-dollar organization, and the plant wasn't performing, meaning its expense level was way too high. And the end result was that the product that they were putting out it was unprofitable. So why? What's going on? And the company makes medical products, and then it also makes some medical ointments and other things that touch the skin. So the ointment skin stuff is controlled by the FDA. So the FDA does have an important role. And so you have to do a lot of different specific processes, a lot of metrics, a lot of quality checks and that kind of thing. And when he did his analysis, he found out that the plant manager, his first step, one of his initial leadership roles, was running the FDA part, which was like 12% of volume. And when he got promoted, he said, man, I got promoted because I'm really good at what I do. So he took those concepts and put them to the rest of the plant, which meant that he put a much higher expense structure into the rest of the plant, and nobody knew it. It's a habit. One of the things we're going to come down to is that culture is just it's a whole bunch of habits. And how do we make sure that we get rid of the bad ones and retain and keep the good ones? They had an accounting function that was very not well advanced, and they did it on using a cash system instead of an accrual system. So they had a misrepresentation of what their expense structure was. Anyway, they couldn't get good product information from a P&L on products. And there are a number of other things like that. So, I mean, how did it get there? It got there because people did the best they could, the best they knew, and because they didn't know. At noontime, I had a lunch with another person who's a CEO, a fairly large organization, a lot of plants, and he's got three people who are over those plants. And he walked into a meeting yesterday, where they were worrying about a person that they're interviewing to hire to a position that's effectively a support position for all three of them. And he was inquiring as to why they were asking, and the discussion was going the way it was, because they weren't really talking about the responses they had gotten from the candidates about the specific questions that would be asked. And what he found out was they didn't meet beforehand and figure out what those questions were, which is their process. I mean, they have a process for making things happen, and these guys, who are fairly high level, weren't using it. I mean, he was furious. I mean, the point is that part of their culture is process. You cannot grow if you don't have process, if you don't know your culture, and you don't have values and those kind of things. They have to be in place, because ultimately those are the things that people grab onto that create the one organization idea. And they didn't in that place, in that point. Some time ago, these are just things that are occurring to me about creating habits within organizations that some are good, some are bad. Worked with one at one point that they decided that responsiveness was one of their major cultural behaviors. And okay, what does that mean? What's the behavior behind responsiveness? They decided that one of those behaviors is that, this is really somewhat prior to email, that we will reply to either emails or voicemails within 2 hours. To at least let the person who called know. If we'd been on lunch or something like that and didn't have it, the moment we got back, we'd call them back or email them back and let them know that we got it, we're working on it, and by tomorrow noon I'll have an answer to you or something like that. And they just started doing that. The end result is a month later, when they had a sales meeting, the salespeople are coming back and people were their customers were saying, how come you guys are so much better than everybody else? All they did was increase their responsiveness to a very specific behavior that people used. What's another one? Michael Milken. Has anybody heard of Michael Milken? Good or bad? Anyway, right. Wishy-washy. He was actually, he's a financier, still alive. Back in the 80s, he's credited with, maybe being one of the most critical people to create the concept of junk bonds. Junk bonds simply means that there were B-level bonds that still get paid back, but they could be used to fund capital improvements, expansion of companies that already had a high debt load. So if you're an expanding company, you have high debt, and here's the next iteration that you want to do, but you've got so much debt that the ratio is not good and you don't get it. Well, if you can take a B bond, pay a higher interest rate, but the point is you get it, and he drove that. He's also one of these minds that doesn't understand creativity. He just does things. He doesn't understand rules and regulations, and he eventually did some things that were illegal and got him put in jail. But he came out of it and created an organization that bought one of my sister organizations, what I work for, and I heard him speak. And he talked about how he evaluates higher level candidates that are going to come into some of the companies that he owns. He said, I do two things. One is make sure that this is out in LA. I say, we're going to take your car and we're going to drive to this place that's far away. And what I'm doing is watching how they drive. And if he just gets in line, that's not good. But if he's passing people, that's good. So that's what he looks for. The second thing he said is, I keep him up late. And then I say, we're going to go play poker or do something, some card game that is competitive between him and me, and I want to watch how he deals with that. And what I'm looking for is when he's tired, does he still make rational judgments and not do things that are major leaps that are dangerous? He doesn't take major chances. That's what he was looking for. That's interesting, I think. And it goes back to people and habits and culture and what you're trying to find. And in those examples, I think I went across the board in different logics about what's important within culture. You're here because I think, like me, you've been struggling to try to figure out what it is and how it works. You've already got the handout, and there's three examples in there of what they can look like. They're different than what people might expect. Culture is about habits, and yes, you can change culture. We're going to talk about that. It's not that hard. Changing culture is like, it's like a revolution. When you have a revolution, you take over something, and you do two things. Number one, you take over the power, the gun, and the other thing is you control communication so that people only hear things that you want them to hear, and they do not hear things you don't want them to hear. So once you start to figure out what are the major cultural behaviors that we need to be successful, and it's nothing new, you're already doing them. Then you look for the behaviors that aren't consistent with that, and somehow drive them out. So that's how you make culture change happen. First of all, though, I want to have some fun with all of us. So everybody find a partner. You're three, so you're going to have to all three be partners. You can be two partners. You know, find a partner, shake their hands, make sure you know the person's name and what organization they're from. It'll take you 30 seconds. Go ahead.
I'm the same way, basically. Nick and I are working together in the mentor program. Nick is not the same way.
Okay, you know it. Now let's do the work. Okay, here's the deal. I want you to take. Okay, you got a piece of paper in front of you. I want you to write down at least one, maybe two or three things that you do within your organization, no matter how small, because what you're doing in your organization you think is better than anybody else. And what are those things that you do that reach out to customers that are better than anybody else? Think about them and write them down. Not big long sentences or paragraphs, but short phrases. What do you do that effectively in your world is world class? For what it's worth, you have customers. They're working with you because you are the best at something. What is that? Write down two or three things. This is important. Do it. It's part of the program. You are better than everybody else at something. What are those one or two or three things? Okay, can somebody share? I want three of them. Just tell me what are something that somebody wrote down. Yes, sir.
Listen to the customer's needs.
Okay, back there.
Time response to issues.
I'm sorry?
Efficient time response to issues.
Okay.
The experience while with us.
Repeat that out louder, please. Okay. Different things. Now, I want you to, everybody, take a look at what you wrote down. And that experience one is an interesting one, because now I want to know what are the experiences that you create. Put them in behavioral terms. Take what you wrote down, if it isn't already in a behavioral term, like listening. I mean, that is behavioral. You're there for that one. Look at the rest of them that you have. And write them in things that if you were to tell someone who's a new employee, when I walk in on Monday morning, here's what you do to do this with the customer, what is it that you do? I mean, some of the things that I wrote down would have been, peace of mind, we provide relieve anxiety, we provide you something that works perfectly, great quality, great price, easy to work with. But what are the specific behaviors that we do? Take a moment and make sure you get them in behavioral terms. Thank you. Okay. Thank you. Okay. Now, let's do another exercising. That one's external. Think about three things that you do, one, two, or three things you do internally to work together to be more effective in serving ultimately the customer. My favorite question in getting at this is, what pisses you off? And I've used that for a long time because it gets at a lot of different things. It gets at mission. It gets at values. It, you know, if something irritates you, it's emotional. That means it's important. So when you reflect back in this little piece of the exercise about someone did something I really didn't appreciate, it pissed me off, therefore it's important, what did I really want them to do? And working together with other people within the organization. We're avoiding dysfunction. Or as I like to say, the organization I work with, we put fun back into dysfunction. But and then the next piece of it, obviously, is make sure you're putting it in behavioral terms. What are these things that we do to work together more effectively? Emphasis on do, the behavior. Okay, now you have another minute and a half to 2 minutes. I want you to share what you've written down with the other people in your row. And this is important, because now you're learning from each other about what they put down. So go ahead, talk. Okay, that's enough. Thank you very much. Sounds like some good discussions were going on. These are the questions I think that are in your minds and that we're going to be dealing with, and it's not going to be a slow process. We'll go through it fairly rapidly. You know, what is it? When I'm going to talk to you about my journey on how I got to where we're going to actually talk about the specifics that are in the examples. Why is it important? How do I articulate it for my own organization? How do I use it so that we're better off? In other words, once you get it, how do you use it? And then how do I maintain it? We'll talk about those kind of things. And of course, my favorite question, my journey. It starts, in a sense, with I was in retailing for a long time, 10 years, and a little more than 10 years, and that's where I started to run into bad bosses. and wondered about why do good people de-energize, perform poorly, and that kind of thing. A lot of it in retailing has to do with just the urgency of everything, that if something didn't sell last weekend, we got to figure out what it is. I was in distribution, we have to get the rest to the stores, we have to figure out what the ad price is going to be, you have to have the ad, you have to have more stuff in the stores the next week. You know, all just the urgency of week to week is just horrendous. And maybe you don't have time to really be more effective, figure out how to be more effective. But anyway, that it was always there. Then you, I get to doing what I'm doing now, which is basically I facilitate CEO groups. I have three of them, and a group of marketing and salespeople, and 12 to 14 typically in a group meet umpteen times, in our case, 9 times a year, half to full day sessions, bring in other resources. And the objective basically is to help people be more effective by sharing what's going on between them, what are their concerns, what isn't working, what's working for you, and that sort of thing. And the culture, and that was back in the days of re-engineering, and then there was a gap before lean, the same concepts came back as lean. But in that middle time, you start to understand why didn't re-engineering work, because it was specific things that were really cool that you could bring into your organization. And we start to learn from people like Peter Drucker and others that the cultures, the soft skills, the capabilities just weren't there. So what are those? And so people wrote some books. And they got a lot of notoriety, and they got paid huge amounts of dollars to go and talk about companies who were doing well and what their values were. Not their culture, their values. And said, if you have these values, then that's why these organizations do well. So anyway, I read the 8 books, and they told me about the values. They never told me how to really figure out what the values were. They never told you, they told you what they were, and that yes, this drives this organization, but they didn't tell you really how you got to them. And then this culture concept comes in, and exactly what is that? And then what it came to me in one of the books was that culture, as a definition, is values plus behaviors. So I said, okay. I'll work on that. I've been hearing a lot about values. Behaviors I get. Behaviors are what you see. They're what you just finished writing down. Values. Now, what are those? And then you get into these wonderful words, you know, like integrity and honesty and respect, the ones that are in your write-up. And say, okay, what do they really mean? And many of them have multiple interpretations. So which one is it? I mean, integrity can go in a whole bunch of different ways. Well, anyway, if you start thinking through for your organization, if that really is an important value, what's a behavior that reflects integrity? In my case, I think it's basically you walk your talk, your handshake is your word, you do what you say you commit to. Those are behaviors. Those are things that you can see people do. You can tell whether or not they really did them. Honesty. What's honesty? We're really not talking about fraud. What are we talking about? Well, okay, and one interpretation would be we're talking about somehow getting on the table early what problems are in ways that people can accept and then do something with. So that's a kind of a problem-solving communications element. But there's doing pieces to it that are beyond just the simple word of honesty. And you can go down the line, and if you start thinking through those things, those become elements of culture. Those are behaviors that are important within our organization, as long as you reinterpret and get away from those friggin' words. Because when you hire somebody and you put those words in front of them and say, these are our values, come in on, you buy into those, the answer is yes. Come in on Monday morning and just start applying them. They'll apply them in whatever way they want to, so which is why you have to get to behaviors. So I simply put the word values before behaviors, and culture is effectively valued behaviors, okay? So there's lots of behaviors, there's 1,000 of them in our organization that really make us effective. What are the top ones that are critical? Okay, this was 20 years ago, and then my thinking stopped because I'm kind of like you. I don't know how to figure out exactly what those most important behaviors are. Until 2 years ago. Why is it important? We've already talked about why it's important. Because we are creatures of habit. We come into organization with habits that need to be adjusted to conform with what we need to happen within the organization. We have habits in the organization that are so friggin' subtle and destructive that we don't know it. It's why good people can be bad bosses. Intuitive, they're doing things that are so subtle we don't know what they are. It's tough to figure out. But the point is that they're there and we need to deal with them. So why is it important? Because we want to get habits that are correct for our organization, and we want to get the most important ones. How do we start to articulate them? David Friedman is my guru. He showed up 2 years ago. He's from near Philadelphia in New Jersey. He took over his father's insurance brokerage business when it had like 15 people. When he finished, it had a little over 100, and he sold it to some big insurance company and probably made a lot of money. But figuring out culture came easy to him. He just sat down and said, what are the most important behaviors that we do to sell insurance and to be effective working behind the scenes to help the people who are selling the insurance? And he came up with ultimately close to 30 behaviors that he felt inside his company were important. And there were things like this. And those are good ones. I mean, if you're looking for takeaways, this is part of his list. They're good. And then within WEECH, and this did not occur quickly. This took like a 5-year process as he figured what they were. And then each one has a small paragraph interpretation underneath it. That kind of explains more about exactly how you behave and what you should do and why it's important type of thing. But that became his driver. And, you know, it's a small organization, you know, 15 people going up to 100. But the point is people could latch on to them. And you could set up reviews to them. You could hire to them with questions. You made sure that anybody within that organization knew that these were the top 30 things that we do to be successful. So we heard that 2 years ago, and a couple of my companies latched on, hired him, and did his process. A number of others started the process without using him, didn't spend the big bucks, and just worked through it logically. There it is again. And the key question is, what pisses you off? So their exercise that they would isn't going to take David Friedman's list, but creating your own. And you do that, and this is how you do it. I mean, I'll give the list of doing it, but this is it. Is you take time and think about things that irritate you, that what people do in your organization that irritate you, and write those down and say, okay, what's the behavior that I want them to do that's the corollary to that, the reverse of that? That becomes one of your elements of the most important behaviors. It becomes the culture. It becomes part of one of those 15 to 25 that you're going to have. Okay? What pisses you off? And I do this with my members. I'll sit in front of them at either in their office or a restaurant or something like that, and I just start picking their brain. And you know, we'll come up with 5 or 6 or 7. And that's a start. And I said, okay, you know, you keep going. And they do. They keep looking and watching. And they'll start to figure out other ones. And anyway, it slowly starts to build. Then one person was going through this and said, something just doesn't feel right. So we started thinking about it. And what didn't feel right was that effectively they're all internal. So what are the external ones? The first exercise we did is what are the behaviors that we do that really make us successful? We can do all this stuff internally and work together really effectively, but darn it, if we aren't doing something that takes care of the customer specifically, then it's all for naught. So what are those things that differentiate us in the marketplace against the competitors and create success? For what it's worth, there's 4 or 5 of them. Maybe 3, but there's 3 or 4 or 5 of them. And in your first exercise, hopefully, you came pretty close to figuring out what those are. One way to, I mean, what you do now isn't the full process. I mean, ultimately, you vet it against other people in your organization to get buy-in and to get their thoughts and that kind of thing. But the point is that that's the first piece of it. And if you look at the examples, that's the first piece in every example. Because if somebody comes here, if we don't do these things, we have no business. So we need to be doing them, and everybody needs to know what they are, and we need to do them. So what are the four or five things that differentiate us? And then the second piece is the other 10 or more that are how we work together to create success. That's the what pisses you off thing. For what it's worth, we're not done, but that's it. I mean, those two elements, and they show up in the examples. If you go to my companies and say, okay, you've been exposed to this, and does the format that I'm showing you show up necessarily in theirs? The answer is no, because part of the process is not that you take Phil's way, which I for what it's worth, I happen to think it's the best, but you have to go back to your organization, your top five or six or seven people, and do the same thing with them. You basically start with a blank sheet and say, okay, what differentiates us in the marketplace? And get their feedback and put it up on a flip chart and get agreement within that group that these are the three or four or five things that we do that differentiate us, that are better than what our competitors do, and get prospective customers to appeal to us. And then the second question is, what do we do to work together more effectively to create success? And you get, and we do the brainstorming of that senior group, and you get that list. That list is not yours, it's not Phil's, it's theirs plus yours. But you're still a boss, and culture is determined by you. So what you do is you then take all of that into a room, you take your first list that you did for yourself, you take their list, you combine them, and you figure out what's right, what's best, and you got it. That's your culture. And you have four or five of the first part of it, and you have 10 or 15 in the second. And if you wait another week or two or 3 weeks, you're going to come up with a couple more. You've got it. There's two elements that when I work with people that frequently don't get in, that I force in to the extent I can, meaning I give them a draft that includes it. One is attitude, that you do have one about attitude. And for what it's worth, nobody can ever come to work with a bad attitude. You are not allowed to. Any bad attitude in any kind of work situation becomes the bad apple that infects all the rest. It de-energizes everybody that entire day, and you're not productive either. So I'm sorry, if you've got a bad attitude for what other reason that you dragged it to work, you can't show it here. You have to be positive. So stop whining, stop doing whatever. I mean, and it gives you something to hang on to have that quick conversation. For what it's worth, when these things are developed, and articulated, and they're on the wall, and we talk about them, then people know it anyway. I mean, you don't even have to remind people because people are already doing it. That's the cool thing. The second thing that I require is one that has to do with personal and professional development. Nobody needs to, wants to work with an organization that isn't going to concretely be doing things to make me better. It's that old bromide that, man, I can't ensure, guarantee employment. Because there's vagaries to that, but I can ensure and guarantee for you employability. We're going to do what we can to develop you so that you're as cutting edge as we can keep you, so that if we can't keep you here, that you're going to go someplace else and succeed. So having a development capability as a piece of what you do is really critical. Nobody's asking questions, but we'll have that time in a little bit. The process, I've kind of talked about it. You develop your own list, then you go, you put that aside, and you go get a blank sheet and get with them and do the same thing, and then you compare the lists and you come up with your own. And it may look like something that's in those examples that I've got there. Now you've got your way. It's very cool. You have you've articulated the most important behaviors that constitute the most important piece of your culture. So how do we use it so that we're better off? Most of these are pretty obvious. From a David Friedman standpoint, these are his elements. They're pretty obvious. The rituals. to and reinforce it. To large extent, remember that we're not creating something new in most of these behaviors. We're simply using a device to pull them out of people's head, get them down on a flip chart, get some agreement with them, and go. They're already in. They're already usually operating. But we can do some. We can do some things that you might call rituals. What people have done, and very successfully in the last year or so with this, one of them is the CEO would take each one in turn, and each week would write up or publish a little video, but do a little write-up, a paragraph or two about why this is important to me. Either some examples from his personal life or his business life or whatever, and he'd do one every week. So if you got, 20 of them, there's 20 weeks. Okay, then what? Well, then you go to another person. You can't then, go to Rick and say, okay, Rick, you do the next 20. But you can go to Rick and say, do the next one. And then somebody else is going to do the second, third, and fourth. So you assign other people in the organization to do them. So that every week, somebody is talking from their standpoint about why a particular one is meaningful to them. And you can really go clear through to the janitor. You can go through to everybody in the organization, and then you can start over. Another organization begins every shift. At the beginning of the shift, you bring everybody together to talk about what we're going to be dealing with, what we're taking over from the prior shift, and that kind of thing. And every shift starts with a quick discussion about one of the ritual cultural elements. That's working for them. It's ways to basically increase the visibility of them so that people know them and understand them, and you make them live. Anybody have a question about any of those? I think they're pretty obvious.
Can I give an example?
Yeah.
Negative side?
Please.
I worked with a client many years ago, and they had an office in Atlanta. They had 125% turnover in that office annually. They were growing very fast, 15% a year for the 3 years that I was around. What I discovered when they flew me out there was that the new hires never were given an introduction to what the culture was. There was no integration. There was no ritual to tell them. In fact, the old guard ate lunch in one place, and the new guard had to sit over there by themselves. And they'd quit because they didn't feel there was a place for them. That is a failure of culture, frankly.
Mm-hmm.
It's costly.
People have other examples? Come on. Everybody has examples. I know it.
Does it get to a point where if it's, I think we all kind of jokingly make fun of the Walmart huddle, which is reinforcing their culture, but does there get to be a point where they're reiterated to the point where they no longer become part of the culture, but they become kind of, it's the rote and they lose their empowerment and they just become...
I haven't been with it long enough. I will tell you, I almost joined Walmart. If I had gone to Walmart, I wouldn't be here today. I came here in 81, and 79 and 80, I interviewed with them down in Bentonville. The organization was small enough that every Saturday morning, everybody in the organization who had any kind of responsibility came into this room that wasn't much bigger than this, like 75 people, that's what it was back then. And you and Sam Walton would sit up there and say, give me a W. And you stood up and you went, W! And then A, the whole thing. I said, can I do that? It's just not me. But that was clearly part of their culture, and I don't know whether it continues today because they got way too many people, but those were the cool meetings that they created every Saturday morning because people were traveling all over the U.S. and they had to come back, and they got together on that Saturday morning to make sure that they'd share what they saw. It was really a cultural building event. I'm sure they don't do it now because it's way too huge. But. Okay, yeah, how do you get buy-in? My stuttering is that ultimately some people won't buy in and they're not going to be with the organization. But most will. I mean, in my experience, what I watch, and I think it's pretty rational, most people are waiting for leadership. They're, I mean, tell us what we should be doing. Who's figured it out? And as long as my experience in doing those kind of things is consistently good, I buy in pretty quickly. So you've got the 15, you know, the bromide about the 15% who are the early adopters. And then if that's working, then the other next 70% will buy into it pretty quickly. And then you got 15% who don't, and those are the people you give a chance to, but they'll eventually churn out. Other questions? For what it's worth, I'm done. The good companies have culture by chance. Great ones have culture by design. You can be great. You can be a two-person company or a much bigger one, but this stuff works.
You use the word ritual, and I'd add to that the word story. You know, I'm thinking of a company that they had their, I think, their 12 values, and every monthly meeting, somebody had to read the values before the meeting began. And I could tell that nobody gave a darn. I mean, you, this is what you had to do, so you just did it. And they, what I posed at one point was, could you please tell me a story around how you've exercised that value?
Right.
That you do? And that became a way of which, by which we made this, these 12 things become alive as opposed to just words we had to say.
Right, you got
to
make the friggin' thing real. And personal, people's personal experiences is always what creates reality. When you talk about, you know, great leaders are great storytellers. What are those stories?
I'd just make a comment. It strikes me that that organizations have a tendency to focus on values rather than behaviors. And when I think about what pisses me off, it's when behavior betrays values. So if I look at the things that piss me off and understand the value it relates to, and I can make that connection then back to the desired behavior, I can start building the stories, and I can also bring some clarity to the values through the behaviors. I mean, focusing on the values is just an abstract exercise. It's not going to carry the organization forward. On the other hand, I need to be able to link those two clearly, and I need to be able to articulate the desired behavior in the context of the work that we're doing together.
Yeah. Did you hear him back there, sort of? I mean, it's really an important point, because ultimately, one of the criticisms of this, for what it's worth, my people who have done this, and others around the country who have taken up David Friedman's ideas here, half a year into it, they're already enthusiastic. Now, I don't know about 2 or 3 or 4 years into it, but it really does seem to energize people, because if you're larger, you got something you can actually tie into. This is what we, who we, if we do these things, I am really enhancing the organization. But you can't, you know, the criticism, well, I can't remember, you know, 15 or 20 or 25. What is this stuff? Why, you know, you can't do that? Well, the point is we can and do because it's right. Well, how do you remember it? You remember it because you come up with words that somehow reflect what it is. Or you go back to your original concepts about the 3 or 4 or 5 word phrases that you use to describe what you are. Or you come up with, you know, the 6 or 7 words that have the behaviors underneath them. But right, the behaviors have to be there. Big point. Somebody else was, yes.
So the your director's statement, culture eats strategy for breakfast. What do you have to say about strategy? I guess I'm concerned that I think they're both important.
Yeah.
If you have all culture and no strategy, well, that's not necessarily a good thing either. And I think there can be an emphasis on, too much emphasis on one to be isn't smart either.
Well, I mean, if you look at the 3 or 4 or 5 things that a leader is supposed to do, one of them is obviously setting strategy, and another is defining values/culture. So they're equal. I mean, they're there. I mean, they're critical. The culture really should become the foundation that supports the strategy. So if you look at the doing part on differentiating, that's clearly related to what we're delivering from a strategic standpoint to our customers. I mean, what I'm trying to say is there's no diminishment. If you don't have culture consistent, I mean, and have finally gotten there. people do what they think is their own interpretation of how they should operate, and things don't get done well. Yeah. I mean, so is mission. So is people selection, you know.
I just add, to me, culture is actually a little longer term than strategy. We change strategy to account for changes in the marketplace. But the culture, if we've done it right, should be consistent through that time frame. And so it takes a little more time to get the culture in place than it does the strategy, even though they're both difficult. I'd say sometimes we're way too much in a hurry to even do a good strategy. We're pretty operational, all of us.
Yeah. Yes, sir.
I just got a question on when you started your presentation. You said good people being bad managers. What is it? Somebody that's really good in their job and now they're a manager, they're just a bad manager, or what is your definition of a good person?
Of a good person,
good
who becomes a bad.
Yeah.
My definition. I'm not sure. Maybe I haven't thought about it clearly enough. I mean, I clearly had some really good people who were my bosses when I was in retailing. And man, did they de-energize me. I mean, I got so pissed off at them. And this was both in distribution as well as in research. They were micromanagers. They were controlling. They were arrogant. Can you help respond to that question? Okay.
I didn't hear your response.
Okay, I mean, he's asking, I mean, what's the relationship between a good person and being ineffective as a manager? And I hadn't thought about it, but I'm thinking about who my criticisms of those people, and it did have to be with micromanaging, controlling, calling me on Sunday afternoons and asked me to do something. I mean, one guy... we were giving birth, my wife was giving birth to our first kid, and we were doing some research through that weekend, and he calls and says, can you work on this while you're in the waiting room down in the hospital? I can't tell you what I thought. I mean, just insensitivity, that's not a good, intelligent, professional response. But. Other questions? Yes, sir. Or comments?
So good people. We have good people in our organization, and some of them have been put in manager positions. They don't necessarily have people skills to know how, so they might micromanage because they don't trust that people will do the job the way they want it done. And they don't know how necessarily to lead them to get the end result. So they're good people, and you really like them, and you want to pull for them, but they annoy you because they're micromanaging you, or they don't allow you the freedom to do what you need to do.
Yeah, or getting to a whole bunch of other things, too, like leadership development and 360s back on, you know, what works for me with you and what doesn't work for me with you and that sort of thing. Right. Yes.
Mm-hmm. But if you have someone who's very goal-oriented and driven and very inner-motivated, you don't micromanage that person. And it's the leader's job to know their employees or their team and understand those differences and work with them to bring the best person forward accordingly.
Yeah, we're into leadership development at this point and mentoring versus coaching and how do you work with people. I mean, great comments. Thank you.
To another point of saying.
Okay, I get you.
Yeah, I was just wondering more about, like, you know, when you have folks come in, you're worried about that strategy versus culture, in a sense, like how those things are developed, and how you spoke a little bit on hiring know, you brought up that story before about, you know, the techniques of that hiring. How do you hire based on culture, and to not only hire based on it, but then to elevate current folks? And I guess it's more leadership question.
Well, I'm not an expert on it, but it's open-ended questions. You try to figure out, I mean, this requires pre-planning, so you take a look at each one of these elements and say, I want to know whether or not this person has really done that in prior jobs. I mean, is it something new, or I mean, hopefully it's not. And you ask some question that'll, as you listen to the response, you'll be able to tell whether or not they're consistent with that. Rick?
Just a thought on that, though. If you've got a good understanding of the behaviors that are necessary to reflect the culture that you believe you have, then you can interview based on whether those behaviors have been evidenced by that candidate in the past.
Right. Does that help? Then I mean, it's not easy. Open-ended questions, trying to figure out what they are.
I thought you had all the answers. That's why.
Yeah. Don't get into the details, right? Someone, you were taught. You went.
Well, and I it kind of speaks to what they're saying is picking the right people that match your culture. You can hire the most intelligent person, but if they can't relate to your people, they're not
going
to fit your culture.
Right. Yeah. Well, Kelly?
We actually just went through this process at the Einstein Project, and we have six values, core values that we have, and we've assigned behaviors, and I need to do a little bit more work on it, but that's how all of our staff are reviewed, and we've actually had some people exit stage left, but we've also become a magnet for new employees who are frankly taking pay cuts to come and work for our company because that's what they believe in. They believe in innovation, they believe in having fun, and those are two of our core values. And they know that they'll actually be able to excel on our team because that's what we live and breathe every single day.
What's a behavior around fun again? You don't have to answer that.
No, but actually you actually had one up on the screen, which is bringing a positive can-do attitude every day and thinking creatively. So, and sometimes that's literally bouncing balls down the hallway. We're planning for our science expo right now, and sometimes that's literally bouncing balls down the hallway. So people will take a pay cut to be able to work in that environment.
But I once spent time with one of my companies, and we were worrying about the behavior underneath the word fun. One of their values was, you know, we're fun. And said, okay, what is fun? I mean, is it you get to wear jeans or you eat the pizza or whatever? And after an hour of discussion, they said, at the end of the day, if you want a person to walk away and say, that was a fun day, their interpretation was, I was doing fulfilling work for the organization and I got recognized for it, which happened to be the two top things from a motivation standpoint as well. Anything? Others? Anna, you want to talk about whatever you want to talk about? I want to say something real quick about mentors, because we have a lot of people here who are not part of the mentoring program. The reason we exist as a program is obviously to take smaller organizations who don't have an advisory board and don't have mentors and are kind of lonely to give them a support capability. And the way it's been created, forgetting the history, is that we need people who are mentors who are fairly broad in their understanding, and it's nice if they're part of a larger organization so that if the person wants to know more about accounts payable or receivables or IT or HR issues or something like that, that there's somebody that they can talk to within that organization. And we go through this process in the fall. And anyway, if people who have an interest in being a mentor on behalf of your organization, we'd appreciate that. Anna wants to know. And plus, you can go to the website and show interest.
Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you, Phil. I think you got the recipe for successful culture. And because a lot of times we'll think about how do we do it? And Phil explained, I mean, it's simple, but after that, the execution and how do you stay focused on the culture, it is very important to do that every single day if you want to be successful. Thank you, Phil. And again, if you want, thank you for the plug for the mentor mentorship program.
So to leave behind, it really is simple. All you got to do is say, what pisses you off?
Yeah, exactly.
And make sure you're looking externally as well as internally.
Yeah,
and it's there.
Everything is emotion, and if you think that you don't belong to that organization, you have to find another organization you kind of match your value with, or if you're a business owner, just make sure that your values align with your employees, so you just have to hire new employees where they will align with your values. Thank you so much, and if you would like, you can network and you can ask Phil more questions. Mm-hmm. Thank you so much, everyone.